Good morning, everyone. Welcome to La Cañada Congregational Church. Today, we're going to continue our exploration of Psalms of lament, of complaint, of just not being happy with the way that God has ordered this world. And so as we come to this morning worship, I want you to bring both the gratitude that you have for the salvation that God brings, as well as all of the pent-up anxiety, frustration, and sadness that it seems that we are experiencing so much of these days. And so we'll begin with our psalmist, our thought that allows us to grasp after the ways of God. Psalm 25, verses 4 and 5 say, "Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me. For you are the God of my salvation. For you, I wait all day long." I hope that in your waiting, you find that God appears to you this morning, that God's presence envelops you in love and in salvation.
Lord, I love all.
Pray with me this prayer of confession. Lord, in you we place our hope. In you we lift our souls up in trust. Send your mercy to us so that we do not stumble. Lift us up so that we do not crumble under the weight of this life. And by your Spirit, help us cling to the life-saving love and faith in Christ. Amen. You know, so often in this world it can feel as if we are just grasping for whatever will keep us afloat. And what we find is that God's Spirit comes to us and lifts us up. That when we cry out to God, that God hears us, stooping low to listen to our cries. Not just our cries on our own behalf, but our cries for others. And so I hope that you would lift up others in this time of prayer. That you would make your request known to God, knowing that God is faithful to hear and to respond.
Thank you.
I invite you to pray with me the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial. Deliver us from evil. For the kingdom and the power and the glory are yours forever. Amen. Do you remember when you stopped being scared of the dark? I was maybe around 10, and I was finally able to give up that Superman nightlight that protected me from any harm that would come from having to crack the door and make sure the hall light stayed on. It was easier for me because I shared a room with my twin brother all of my life, at least when I was a kid. And so I had an accessible ally who was there to help resist any alien abduction that would make its way to our Texas trailer park. But you know, as adults, there are sometimes moments when the darkness scares us. If you're a parent, you've experienced the most terrifying reality when your four-year-old child appears by your side at 2 a.m. just to stare at you while you sleep, and the presence in the room awakes you to the terror of a child just there. Fears often come back, though, when we're alone. I know for me, if the kids are gone and Erica is out of town, suddenly the familiarity of home turns into something dangerous, something threatening. Are the doors locked? Even the back door? Darkness can feel isolating, can separate us. And what we find in Psalm 88 is this expression of dread as the darkness closes in and further isolates the psalmist, where they realize there is no one around them, no friends, no family, no God. And so I'd like us to do something a little different this morning. I would like you to read aloud with me Psalm 88. I would like its words to become your words. Maybe you're experiencing something right now similar to what the psalmist is going to express. But if not, you have at some point. And I would guess that you probably will at some point in the future. And so let's make these words our own as we seek to understand why we would cry out to God in such a way. So let's read Psalm 88 together. O Lord, God of my salvation, when at night I cry out in your presence, let my prayer come before you. Incline your ear to my cry. For my soul is full of troubles, and my life draws near to Sheol. I am counted among those who go down to the pit. I am like those who have no help, like those forsaken among the dead, like the slain that lie in the grave, like those whom you remember no more, for they are cut off from your hand. You have put me in the depths of the pit, in the regions dark and deep. Your wrath lies heavy upon me, and you overwhelm me with all your waves. You have caused my companions to shun me. You have made me a thing of horror to them. I am shut in so that I cannot escape. My eyes grow dim through sorrow. Every day I call on you, O Lord. I spread out my hands to you. Do you work wonders for the dead? Do the shades rise up to praise you? Is your steadfast love declared in the grave, or your faithfulness in Abaddon? Are your wonders known in the darkness, or your saving help in the land of forgetfulness? But I, O Lord, I cry out to you. In the morning, my prayer will come before you. O Lord, why do you cast me off? Why do you hide your face from me? Wretched and close to death from my youth up, I suffer your terrors. I am desperate. Your wrath has swept over me. Your dread assaults destroy me. They surround me like a flood all day long. From all sides, they close in on me. You have caused friend and neighbor to shun me. Darkness is my only companion. So you can probably tell why this psalm is not in most lectionary readings. This is not something that we really want to read out loud in church with other people. Most psalms of lament that are in scripture often would include a tag at the end, some expression of hope or resolve, you know, and yet God will be there for me. But this psalm doesn't have any of that. In fact, throughout it, God is hidden, too distant to hear the cries of the psalmist, too far away to be able to come and save them from this watery grave that is pushing them deeper and deeper into despair. And I think a psalm like this forces us to examine our expectations of faith. You know, so often in worship, It's filled with language of virtue, of love and hope, of peace, of forgiveness and restoration. Very rarely does our worship center around ideas of depression and anger and doubt. And if they do, we would sing about them as if they're just temporary bumps in the road, something that we'll be able to overcome if we just had a little bit more faith, if we just sense God's presence a little bit more, if we would just apologize and get over ourselves. And so this psalm feels like it just doesn't belong in public. Maybe if we were feeling this way, it would be okay to read it at home, not admit to it, find some connection to it there by ourselves. But to tell other people, to let them know that we feel this way about God, that can be dangerous. I mean, where's the confession within this psalm? Where's the contrition, the apology of saying, Lord, I shouldn't be feeling like this? We don't have that anywhere. The consistent theme in this psalm is that God is to blame. You put me in the pit. Your wrath is heavy upon me. You have made all my friends leave. You have cast darkness upon me. You have hidden your face. When I read this psalm, I want to back away from whoever's talking and say, lightning's coming any minute for this dude. And so often our Christian response to this sort of attitude, this sort of perspective, is to give them the easy Christian answers. Well, they just need to express a little more gratitude. They need to let go and let God. And it seems that at this point, for this psalmist and any who would find these words comforting, that's just not going to work anymore. You know, no one really tells us that our faith in God will be challenged. And so I'm doing that right now. And I know that many of you have had this faith your whole life. And you've probably experienced these frustrations. But, you know, there's these moments where we encounter such difficulty with trying to reconcile who we are and how we feel with what we're told to believe about God, that it just doesn't seem to mesh anymore. And I've met so many people who when that collision comes, faith just doesn't fit any longer. And so they leave it behind. But I'm really convinced that the emotions expressed in this psalm are crucial in the development of our faith, in the maturity that has to come to see it as nuanced, as more filled with gray than maybe what we were taught when we were kids. Because the reality is our faith is not disconnected from our life. You know, we often treat Sundays or sanctuaries or the songs of Christian experience as this transcendent experience, this escape from the reality that we often have to go through Monday through Saturday. And so we pretend that our religion is a way that can pull us beyond all of this and into a celestial realm that is free from suffering and loss, that allows us to discount the pain because our faith is so full and vibrant that the troubles of this world don't bother us. You know, we sing that we once were lost. We were blind, but now we're found. Now we see. Now we've left all of that behind. And so the question comes, what happens if we get lost again? What happens if the blindness comes back? And I think maybe that's why this psalm is here, to remind us that that's going to happen, that our faith is rooted in this real experience, that life is not just a steady climb of progress up to this pinnacle experience of who God is and God's presence now washing us clean of all of our sins and we find ourselves escorted into the heavenly realm. But instead, it is often one step forward and two steps back, stumbling and losing our way, chasing after diversions on the path, and then hoping we can find our way back. Don't get me wrong. I think the Christian faith is liberating. It's joyous. It's something that when I lose those moments, I long for them. I do what I can to reclaim them. But I'm going to lose those moments. And I think ignoring that can do us harm. To pretend that faith in God is only supposed to be happy and peaceful and joyful, I think we do a disservice to the stories of Scripture, where so often what we read is pain among the people who fervently love and experience God. Confusion, difficulty, setback. And so just plastering a smile on our face because we're about to pray or sing a song or hear a sermon, that can be an incredibly lonely experience because it fails to reveal what's happening inside. And I think that's why it's important that we would sing this song with other people, that I asked you to read it out loud with me. Because we need to hear ourselves say it, even if we don't experience it at that moment. The words, that darkness is all that I have, need to be part of our vocabulary. You know, it's almost October, which means it's almost time for Christmas music on the radio. And while we're singing about animated snowmen and rocking around the Christmas tree and just enjoying the drive down the highway with this festive cheer, inevitably, the DJ is going to slide in there, the king of rock and roll singing about blue Christmases. Or even worse, your favorite bands from the 80s reminding us that there is suffering and starvation happening in Ethiopia and wondering, do they even know it's Christmas time at all? Why would we include those kind of songs in the midst of what's supposed to be a joyful, happy season? I think it's the same reason why these psalms make their way into our reading, is that we have to remind ourselves that in the midst of all that we have to be joyful about, of all the ways that the divine floods our reality and fills us with hope and peace and goodness, that there is a reason we need all that, because the world is also filled with despair and hunger, with poverty and neglect. Our souls are wearied and unable to tread water. We find ourselves beginning to sink. If the Christian faith was only fluff of chestnuts roasting on an open fire, well, it wouldn't be real. And I think the message of Scripture is that we don't have to be divine to cry out to the divine. That in fact, the stories of Scripture, inspired and driven by God's Spirit, have a human hand that crafted them. That even the text that informs so much of our faith is this merger of the fallible and the hopeful. So why can't our lives be the same? The psalmist envisions themselves falling deep into a pit, this cistern that is filling with water, closing off light and voice and sound and becoming a watery grave. And I think that it's important when we sing these songs, when we recite them and hear them, when we build an entire worship service around them, that we remember the times when we received news so terrible that our field of vision collapsed and all that we could see was darkness. And when we sing this song, God wants us to remember that. Have you ever felt as if God is acting against you? That God is deliberately oppressing you? That God is acting in a way to prevent you from seeing your hope come true? When we sing this song, God wants us to remember that. Have you ever felt abandoned, rejected by those that you've loved, betrayed by those who are closest to you? When we sing this song, God wants us to remember that. Because our feelings are not the summation of our faith. That what we find is that this psalmist, in spite of all of this despair, continues to cry out. The psalm starts with a song that is cried out into the night. God, come and save me. And it ends with a commitment that come morning time, I'm continuing to sing this song. Until you respond, God, I'm going to cry out. Sometimes all we have to sing is the blues. Sometimes the only thing we know to say is the complaint, the anxiety, the overwhelming sense of how wrong everything is. But the psalmist says, I can't sing when I'm dead. Words don't matter in the realm of forgetfulness. Sheol and abandon don't have the hymns we sing. And so I'm singing while I'm still alive, even if this is all that I know to sing. And I see that as an act of worship, as an act of commitment, a faith that God has hidden from me. But God can't stay hidden forever. And so I hope that you would find the words here once more encouraging, in spite of nothing being encouraging about them. That you find solidarity with one who would write the song and one who would sing it continually after all these years. And that you would know when you find yourself in this moment, scared of the dark, scared of the isolation, that we continue to cry out. We continue to sing. We continue to hope, maybe even against all hope, that God continues to listen to us. And so I hope that you can act in faith. That even if darkness is all that's around you, you wait for the morning and for the light of God to arrive. Amen.
Carry me. storm. And even though I'm walking through the valley of the shadow, I will hold tight to the hand of Him whose love will rescue me. And when all hope is gone and I've been wounded in the battle, He is all the strength that I will.
Even though so much of our world can be filled with this overwhelming sense of distress, frustration, and sadness, I hope that in our worship this morning, you found not only solidarity with those who experience that reality, but also the hope that God will carve out space for those experiences, for those feelings, for that reality where we feel adrift, that God will surround us with God's presence, that salvation can indeed come, that God remains with us when we are distant. And so this week, in those moments where it feels as if the waters of the flood will surround you, continue to call out for God. Await God's hope and salvation. Amen.